I want to go ahead and move into section 3.3 now. And the idea is that maybe after some time we've noticed that we're sort of doing the same limit proofs over and over again. They're almost predictable in how they're going to work out. And once you realize that, you can start developing some generalized limit rules. Okay? So, the first one that we want to talk about is how do we take the derivative of a constant? So there's two ways to look at this problem. One is you could look at the graph of a constant function, and we'll do that in just a second. You could look at the graph of a constant function and say, what is the slope of the tangent line anywhere along this constant function? But here's a better way to think about this problem. A derivative measures how something changes with respect to a very small incremental change in x. So let's ask the question, how does a constant function change as x changes? Okay, let's talk about that again. How does a constant function change as x changes? It doesn't. So what should it be its derivative? Its derivative is zero. Keep that in mind. Okay? So the derivative of a constant is zero. Let's prove that one real quick. Okay? So if I give you the function f of x is equal to c, let's find its derivative. Okay? Folks, everyone, for 1 point, show me you've learned the definition. That's worthwhile, right? So that would be f of x plus h minus f of x all over h. Now this next part is, it's almost too much of a special case here to keep going. Every time you evaluate a constant function at any point, it always returns, in this case, it returns c. Right? It returns c. If you evaluate at 20, it returns c. If you evaluate at 15, it returns c. Let's evaluate it at x plus h. What does it return? Returns c. What about if we evaluate it at x? It returns a c, because it's a constant function, right? Well, that's just the limit as h approaches 0 of 0 over h, which is just the limit as h approaches 0 of 0. What is the limit of a constant? It's the constant. Okay, so that's a way to prove that the limit of a constant function is zero. What do we see happen? Well, before we ever get around to trying to evaluate the limit, the numerator tends towards zero. The numerator doesn't tend towards zero. The numerator is zero. So the limit of a constant, just that constant, so we end up with just zero. So here's a specific example. If we looked at the graph of f of x equals 3, there's the graph of that function. At any point along here, if I tried to draw a tangent line and calculate the slope of the tangent line, what is the slope of the tangent line anywhere along this function? The slope of the tangent line is 0. So that means the derivative is identically 0. Okay. Questions on that? Groovy. Let's look at the next one. The derivative of the identity function is 1. What's the identity function again? What is the identity? So the identity function is just the function f of x equals x, right? How does it work? Well, if you plug in a 20, what does the identity function spit out? 20. And if you plug in minus 5, what does the identity function spit out? Minus 5. Okay. So let's look at the limit. F prime of x would equal the limit as h approaches 0 of f of x plus h minus f of x all over h. Well, that's the limit as h approaches 0. So what's the identity function evaluated at x plus h? It's itself, x plus h. Minus, what's the identity function evaluated at x? It's x all over h. How we doing? This should actually kind of feel a little comforting at this point. You've been doing these over and over again. We're just making some general rules now using this limit definition. We've got the limit as h approaches 0. What does this clean up to be? It cleans up to be h over h, which is the limit as h approaches 0 of 1, which is what? Which is 1. Okay. There's the identity function, f of x equals x. And here's its derivative, f prime of x equals 1. Okay, folks, first of all, let me say, neither of these two derivatives have been very interesting. How come? One way to look at it is that calculating a derivative is sort of like giving a linear approximation to how the curve was behaving. Well, if your curve is already a line, then finding a linear approximation of your line isn't really going to be very revelatory. Okay? So what we've said here is you pick any point along here and you find the slope of the tangent line. What's the slope of the tangent line anywhere along here? It's just the slope of the line itself, right? Slopes of tangent lines of linear functions are just the slope of that linear function. It's not very exciting. These are two very intuitive questions. Okay? In fact, in some ways, doing the proof makes it muddier than you need to make it. How does this function change as x changes? It changes by a factor of 1. If this were the function g of x equals 5x minus 2, how does this function change as x changes? It changes by 5. Okay? So its derivative, it's just its slope. That should make sense. Because anywhere along this line, 5x minus 2, if you drew a tangent line, what would be the slope of the tangent line? 5. Okay. So this is not very exciting. Derivatives don't get exciting when you're analyzing linear functions. Let's move on. So for here, let's find f prime of x. F prime of x is equal to the limit as h approaches 0 of f of x plus h minus f of x all over h. Boy, he keeps writing that definition over and over again. You'd think he'd already know it by now. Let's go ahead now tailor the definition to the specific function we're looking at. This would be x plus h quantity squared minus x quantity squared, or just squared, all over h. This is equal to the limit as h approaches 0. Foiling out the numerator gives us x squared plus 2xh plus h squared, and then we get the minus x squared term that was on the far right there, all over h. This should start to feel a little repetitive. It's supposed to, because we're trying to come up with some generalized rules. All right. You clean up what you can. You're left with 2xh plus h squared over h, which is the limit. After you cancel out an h, you'd be left with 2x plus just one factor of h. Apply direct substitution, you get 2x plus 0. What is the derivative of the function x squared? It's 2x. If I'm going too fast for you folks, I think that's okay. Because you should just be able to work these out on your own too and just confirm at the end that you get the same answer as I do. Questions so far? I'd like to now graph these two functions. What does the function f of x equal x squared look like? It looks like this. When you plug in a 2, it spits out a 4. Boy, it's kind of hard to see these. Hopefully you can see them on your paper. I think you should be able to see them on your paper, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. So this was the function f of x equals x squared. This was its derivative. F prime of x is equal to 2x. This is the first one that's, I would argue, is even remotely interesting. the big picture, in the big picture, notice that sometimes the red curve is decreasing. Notice that where the red curve is decreasing, that's precisely where the blue curve is below the x-axis. When the red curve is decreasing, the blue curve is negative. When the red curve is increasing, the blue curve is positive. When a function is decreasing, its derivative is negative. Okay? Folks, these are these graphs that I'm saying it is, you know, when you're supposed to put in 20 hours a week studying for this accelerated course, some of the work you should be doing is exploring a function's graph and its derivative's graph and looking at how they communicate with one another, how they compare to one another, what one informs you about the other. Okay. Just for fun, let's go here to x equals 1, and let's draw a tangent line there. What is the slope of that tangent line? Yeah, the slope of this line is 2. How do I know that? Because what's f prime of 1? Oops. What's f prime of 1? It would be 2 times whatever your x-coordinate is, which is 2 in this case. So the derivative here, the slope of the tangent line, is 2. Notice what point is this on the graph? That's the ordered pair 1, 2. Let's do another one. Let's go to negative 2 on our graph and draw a tangent line. Boy, that's pretty ugly. Sorry about that. What's the slope of that tangent line there? Certainly negative. What is it? What's that, Amy?
Negative 4.
Do you agree? I agree. How could we see that? What is f prime of negative 2? Well, the derivative we said is the function 2x, right? So we do 2 times negative 2, which gives us negative 4. Okay. Sure enough, that's the ordered pair on this graph. Negative 2 comma negative 4. What does the negative 4 correspond to? This slope of the tangent line at x equals negative 2. Okay. It is worth putting in some time. Compare these two. It pays big dividends later on in the course, I promise.